that's where I go. Singing songs I've never sung. Oh my God, when I see you I should run. But I'm frozen in motion and my head tells me to stop, tells me to stop. Feelings I feel about us. Try to fight it but it's never enough. My heart is hurting, it's more than a crush. Cause I'm frozen in motion and my head tells me to stop. But my heart goes bum-bum-bum-bum.
All right, 614 Startups Nation. This is Elio Harmon. I am so excited. Been looking forward to this day and so excited to be part of the Tech Life Live platform. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the founder of 614 Startups. It's a podcast that covers the Columbus startup ecosystem. And I'm so fortunate to be part of this group that's launching this new live series. And I have a very special guest today, Randy Gerber of Gerber LLC. Now, before we get into the guest, I want to lay out some ground rules. If you haven't checked out one of these live sessions before, it is live and it is being recorded. And I'm being assisted today by Brian Fishman, my super producer. My super producer. This is live. I'm going to make mistakes like that. And he's going to be watching the chat because we want this to be interactive. If you hear something that resonates with you, put it in the chat. If you have a question, we're going to do a Q&A after about a 30, 35 minute conversation between myself and my guest. Put it in the chat. Brian is going to be curating those. He's going to share it with me, and then I'm going to share it with the guest. All right. Special thank you to our sponsors, right? I think we're being sponsored or supported by Franklin University, Tech Elevator, and Revel. So thank you so much for the sponsors that make this show possible. All right, let's get this show on the road. This has been about a year in the making for me and my very special guest, Mr. Randy Gerber, to actually get a chance to sit down. And now we're finally here. So Randy, welcome to the show. It's so great to have you.
Thanks for having me. I'm happy to be here and super excited about what you're doing and more excited about your passion around it. I think one thing we know about entrepreneurs is passion is really part of the pie there. It's really important.
Yeah, sometimes passion is the only fuel, right? When energy runs out and it's a couple of late nights in, we sometimes rely just strictly on passion to keep us running. So let's put some context in place for passion, our conversation.
Passion or stupidity, one of the two, I don't know.
But. Well, I'm going to go with passion, okay? Well, put it in the chat if you think it's passion or stupidity, audience, okay? Because that might be really, let's see the percentages, right? How much passion, how much stupidity keeps us going? We want that chat to be really engaged. We want you to be a part of this conversation. All right, so context for our conversation. So here's the topic we're going to talk about today. Do I have what it takes to be an entrepreneur? And here's why I asked that as the first question on episode one, right? Entrepreneurship is ultra popular right now. Additionally, becoming an entrepreneur is not always a choice in today's world. And so when I was thinking about guests to bring on, Mr. Entrepreneurship himself, Mr. Randy Gerber, is going to try to help us answer those questions. Now, Randy, your bio is, you know, it reads like everything we need for somebody who's in your chair right now. But I'd like you to kind of give us a bit of your personal background and share some of your professional background as well.
Yeah. So married, three kids, a daughter at Ohio State, and two boys at high school, and live in Columbus, from Buffalo, New York, and came to Ohio State and really very unsure what I wanted to do, and ended up, frankly, I came to Ohio State on an engineering scholarship, and I knew I didn't want to be an engineer. So, and I liked the college lifestyle, and the only kind of thing I could do was become a financial planner, a financial advisor back in 91 actually. And so the first 10 years of being in business, I sold anything to anybody, didn't matter, not from Columbus. So I did a lot of cold calling and a lot of just networking and events. And this is before internet and before cell phone. I carried around a whole bunch of quarters to make calls from pay phones to people at different times in the day, which I still kind of chuckle at doing. Anyways, the market crashed in 2000, and you know, I had a lucky run there where pretty much investments went up for 10 years straight in a row. And so I thought I was really smart, and my clients thought I was really smart, and realized in 2000 I wasn't so smart. Because it was an emotional disaster for us and for our clients. We lost money for the first time, but it wasn't a small percentage, it was over 30%. And 2001, market went down again. Of course, we have 9/11, which really was hard for all of us. My first child was born in 2001. And I really sat there and said, you know, I don't love what I'm doing every single day. But I liked being in the business of advice, and the economics were too good at that point in time to stop. And so I took a hard look at our client base and everything. And I said, you know, I really love the energy from entrepreneurs. Like I get a lot of energy in talking to entrepreneurs. And as time went on, you know, 2003, it was like, well, it's not just entrepreneurs I get most of my energy from. It's the first generation entrepreneurs, the people who are starting the business. And we can spend time if you want to later how I define that, but by and large, people who put their neck on the line and put their life on the line. And so in 2004, we made a decision to transition to only working, or I guess 2004 was primarily working with first generation entrepreneurs. And 2007, it was exclusively. So in 2007, we actually went through the very painful process of professionally, politely moving clients off our books to better advisors, better suited for them. And, you know, the real recognition was, okay, if we're going to work exclusively with first generation entrepreneurs, their biggest and most important asset is their business. And so we better figure out how to help them grow a better business. And one of the huge gaps I saw then, and I still see it today, frankly, is that, you know, entrepreneurs are, well, this is not the gap. They're cup half full people. They are believers. They don't have problems in their life. They have opportunities to fix. And so one of the things that, and you know, being married to an entrepreneur is really hard. And let alone if you have two entrepreneurs married to each other, it's even harder. But anyway, you know, what because entrepreneurs' cups are half full and they really are looking at the future, one of the things that we really figured out is to help them identify and crystallize at a very, very root level. What are your life goals? What are you trying to accomplish? And what we learned was that they were trying to accomplish, they wanted to live life in experiences. It wasn't things that they cared about. And to this very day, 220 clients later, they still don't care about things. They care about people, and they care about experiences, and they care about causes. And we have a process that's proprietary, so we really root that out. So once we understand how they want to live their life, we can help them grow their business with purpose. And so we really help them say, okay, look, if this is how you want to live your life, to go from where you are today and where you need to be, here's what has to happen. And we align all those things. So, you know, and it's exciting because entrepreneurs, they love that, they do believe in my heart, most entrepreneurs believe they're changing the world by they have a better product, a better solution, and they have a better environment for their employees, and their employees can be better spouses and better parents. The world wins. It just wins. And so, that's my background, how we got to where we've gotten.
Yeah, and we're going to talk about pivoting because you had some time there. You kind of weathered the storm multiple times, kind of story of the entrepreneur, classic, and then the big pivot. And you talk about going through the pain, but let's back up just a bit because we're using this term entrepreneur. And before we started recording and before most people joined the room, you made a point to specify that you had a definition of what an entrepreneur is. So let's start by, what is your definition of an entrepreneur?
So in my experience and my opinion, it's a person who's willing to go at risk in every level. They go at risk with their relationships, first and foremost. They go at risk with their legacy at that point in time. They go at risk financially, and they go at risk for their leadership skills. Because every entrepreneur, no matter what type of leader you are, you have to lead. And oftentimes that leadership transcends not just your business life, your personal life. So to me, it's a person who's going at risk at all those levels. And they're looking forward to it, looking forward to going to the unknown and all these. And because it all changes. Financially, it changes, your experiences change, relationships change, solving problems changes, and you're willing to do that. You're willing to own it and take ownership of that.
Is an entrepreneur somebody who's doing it full-time, or can I call myself an entrepreneur if I'm doing it, if I'm working a full-time job and I'm doing it on the side?
Yeah, I mean, no. One of the problems we have right now, and for a little bit, it's been really cool to be an entrepreneur. And the reality of the situation is it's really hard to be an entrepreneur. And I just don't know how you can't be anything but fully committed. So to me, you know, if you have a job and have something on the side, it's just that, it's a side gig. And there are people out there who are entrepreneurial for sure. And I think, you know, that's one of the things with America that's been changing in a very positive way is that, in my opinion, the country's gotten more and more entrepreneurial there's the gig economy, there's side gigs, and I think people in some situations view their careers as entrepreneurial, and that's terrific, but those are all different than being an entrepreneur. You are both feet in the water. You're swimming without a life vest. You're out there, and you're on your own. And so when you have a job, you're really not out there, in my opinion.
So in the chat, you heard that. Now we have a definition of entrepreneur, right? It's about risk, right? You're going in, you're risking it, you're putting it all on the table, right? And then number two, it's not a part-time thing, it is a full-time thing. So in the chat, definition one, you've risked it, you're on the table, and you're full-time, put a one in the chat. If you're working a gig full-time thinking about becoming an entrepreneur, put a two in the chat. And if you're working a gig and you have a side hustle, put a three in the chat. All right. So let's get a sense of who we have in this room as we continue the conversation. All right. So now we have our definition of an entrepreneur, but it takes, not everyone maybe starts out right out of the bat. First career is becoming an entrepreneur. Let's talk about the preparation in order to enter this world. So I'm interested maybe I have a side gig. How do I go from that, right, to full time? What's the mindset first? And what are some things that you're talking about people who are thinking about this, they need to start preparing for instead of just taking the leap? Or is it best just take the leap because there's nothing really that prepares you for entrepreneurship?
Well, as you know, Elio, there's no one answer to that question, because for some people, based on their life circumstances, they're choosing just to jump in and there's no preparation, and that might be the very best thing for them. There are some people who are forced into it, not by their own desire. And you know, that's one of the, you know, good and bad things of COVID is that we did a study on this. There's a lot more people who are entering the world as entrepreneurs today, in part because they were forced. Then there are the people who definitely see a better way to do things. They work for a company and they become disenfranchised for whatever reason, and they go to solve the problem better on their own. And the preparation for those people, you know, it's a combination of, and I can't stress this enough, the ones who do it the best is they're preparing their relationships. You know, because it's so remarkable when you go out at risk on your own, how other people, what we call naysayers here, that, and actually we have a book coming out in the fall about this very topic, that, you know, so many folks aren't equipped to be entrepreneurs themselves, that while they might love the person who's the entrepreneur and love and talking to them, they don't know how to help them in a constructive, positive way. So you have to put your blinders on and ignore all the naysayers and just, you know, believe in yourself, talk to other entrepreneurs. That's a huge, I mean, that's, I will say this, if you're gonna go out and put your shingle out there on your own to prepare, you have got to talk to other people who have done it already. Whether they won or lost, doesn't matter, talk to those folks. Back to the preparation for somebody who's been deliberate, prepare your spouse and your children, get your financial house in order in every way, because it all matters. And again, I don't know there's a one's better than the other in terms of just jumping in with both feet and being innovative and figuring out versus preparation. And I don't know there's any statistics that support either one is better, but it really comes down to circumstances in my experience.
All right. So it's just like financial planning, right? Everybody's path to financial independence is different, but there are some foundational things, right, in finances. And I'm kind of using this analogy because you come from that world. So spend less than you earn, save some money, invest. So what are those fundamental things? Let's put aside the everybody is unique.
Yeah. Oh, no, I can't answer that question.
What are those foundations? Do I need to read a book? Do I need to talk to other entrepreneurs? Do I need to get a mentor? What are those fundamental things that are principles, right? To putting all things aside that could be applicable to anybody thinking about doing this.
Yeah. So number one, just completely without doubt, is understand cash flow. And so if you have to read a book, get a mentor, hire the right bookkeeping service or controller, or all of the above, most likely, that is critical and paramount. But the number one thing that entrepreneurs have to understand is cash flow week to week, month to month, quarter to quarter, year to year. It's the number one trait of putting out a business quickly, and also if you can manage it well, helping you be successful. In terms of things to do, I will say there's probably three. You know, Jim Collins has rewritten a book, his first book he ever wrote, and it was sold to a publisher that didn't do a very good job. His new publisher, his publisher he's had forever, just bought the company. It's called Beyond Entrepreneurship 2.0. It is truly a how-to to grow a business. It's phenomenal. Number two, you know, talk to, you know, if you can get a mentor who's been there, done that as an entrepreneur, that's terrific, or mentors. Certainly, you know, 2B is talk to people who've done it at least. It's Jim Collins, not Fred Collins, Jim Collins, Beyond Entrepreneurship 2.0. and then, you know, thirdly, you need to definitely get, this is a foundational mistake, you need to get, you know, a bookkeeper or maybe a controller, and you can outsource this, because I see this all the time when we start with clients that their financials are just like, they're a mess and they don't know how to create cash flow. Cause that all comes down to you have to have cash flow. Otherwise you'll be out of business.
All right. So chat guys, let's do a little scale here in terms of understanding of cash flow. 10 being your Randy Gerber level. You understand cash flow, not just on an intellectual level, you're actually creating cash flow in your business. That's a 10. And then let's call a 1. I'm so bad at it. I'm underwater and, you know, I need help fixing it right now. All right. So I know 1 is kind of a negative way of putting it, but wherever you think you fall in that range, I'd like to see where we are from a knowledge standpoint of cash flow, because Randy, maybe we need to dig into that a little bit more in helping people understand that. All right. But let's keep it going. There's risk mitigation as well, because you're talking about fundamental things. Sometimes entrepreneurs can break that can't be fixed, like the relationship with your family. I could break my business. I could fix my cash flow, right? There's some things I could do wrong on the business side that can be fixed. On the family side, I mean, that's a real risk. Let's talk about risk mitigation strategy. So I might be the entrepreneur who gets fired from a job and I have no choice. That's a little bit different risk than somebody who has kind of a good situation, stable situation with commitments that they're making. So what do you think about, what do you advise people on risk mitigation around the things that can't be fixed? Because everything else on the business side, you know, theoretically can be fixed with time.
It's interesting you say ask the question that way, because I'm sitting here listening and like, well, what can't be fixed? Everything can be fixed. That's my first reaction to that. Like, you know, if you're committed, everything can get fixed. And the question is, do you want to fix it? Right. And so risk mitigation, probably the best tool to fight risk mitigation is truth telling. And that is around, what is the reality of your situation? What really is happening? One of the things I love about entrepreneurs in general, and particularly first generation entrepreneurs, is they're okay using hope as a strategy, even though they shouldn't. And that's partly because cups are half full and they believe in themselves and they're confident. I do see that if you know, to mitigate risk, particularly at early stage businesses and startup businesses, it's truth telling around what the reality of the situation really is. I can't tell you how many times I've heard from our clients, or even, you know, my wife were on this, she'd say she heard it for the first, you know, 15 years of our marriage, that if I could just get one more, whatever, one more client, one more account, one more, an increase of a line of credit, one more employee, we're there. And, you know, I've heard that a zillion times from people over time, and it just doesn't work. I mean, it might work, but it's accidental. And rooted in your question of risk mitigation, be a truth teller. You know, I think about this kind of regularly, that had I been a better truth teller to myself when I was 21, 22, 25, 27, 30, this business would be a lot bigger than where it is today. Not that it's not, I mean, we'd be further along than we are. So that's your best risk mitigation strategy for sure.
All right. Truth telling. I love it. And it's coming to grips with some things, right? And being real. And sometimes I think when we're running on hopium, I like that, Ted Fireman, when we're running on hopium, it's hard to see the truth, or we avoid seeing the truth. So the value also, again, of that cash flow analysis and hiring somebody who could look at your books, like a Book and Street, who we use here at 614 Startups, they're going to help you with that reality check, right? Yep. So sometimes we're avoiding seeing reality, even though it might be right in front of us. All right, so let's talk about other skills. One of the skills of entrepreneurship I hear all the time is the ability to sell, right? So, you know, mindset, we understand that we're taking risks. This is something that we want to approach all in. We want to go full time if we can. We talked about risk mitigation. We talked about understanding cash flow. Let's talk about the skills, the essential skills, sales, others that you found among the most successful entrepreneurs that you work with.
Yeah, I mean, on the sales part specifically, we see it all the time where businesses are entrepreneur dependent on revenue. And it's hard for entrepreneurs to make that transition where the revenue shifts from their responsibility to others. And, you know, I guess another risk mitigation strategy and also related to the skills is, and it took me a long time to really truly understand and learn this, but you need to have a value-driven business that you hire and fire your employees to your company's core values. And so when you do that, it helps you hire better people, the right people to sell for you. It helps you hire better people to run your financials better or operate better. So as an example, our values first and foremost is be present and be positive. We're not going to hire somebody who has a negative attitude. And you know, as time's gone on, we've had people who develop negative attitudes and they've had to move on to places where they can be positive. Our second value is bold pursuit of excellence. So I don't want somebody coming here to be mediocre. That's not interesting to me. I want them to come here and be excellent, excellent for each other as team members and excellent for our clients. Live and breathe entrepreneurship. That's worded very specifically because you can't have a team full of entrepreneurs, but you can have a team that are fully committed to entrepreneurs and entrepreneurism. And so I don't expect all my team to be entrepreneurs or even entrepreneurial, but I totally expect them to support the ecosystem that revolves around that. And lastly, healthy sense of urgency. It took us about 2 days to insert the word healthy into that. I wanted a sense of urgency. My team think that's, you know, your sense of urgency and ours is different. So we define healthy. And so when you drive a company by core values, everything falls in line from the standpoint of who you're hiring, what they're doing. You know, for us, even now, we won't take a new client unless they meet those core values. Yeah. I don't want to work with a person who's negative. They can't be present, can't be positive. That's not interesting for us, right? But I think that's, and I don't know if it's a skill, really, but you have to understand, and we see this all the time. Companies that have core values and they know them from the beginning just do better in every way. When we define when we say successful entrepreneur, our definition is the owner, the entrepreneur is a happy person, because you can be really miserable and successful financially, but you got to be a happy person. You're leading in your space and you're financially successful. You're making money. But you could be completely miserable and make a boatload of money, and that's not a win, in my opinion, at all.
Okay, so you agree that sales is important, but the ability to hire and fire is critical to success. We're gonna get into team building, but I wanna kinda, you know, open this up because part of this is really sharing your personal experience with these things as well. So with all the experience that you have, we're continually learning. What are some areas that you feel, hey, you know, I feel like I'm sure about this, these are areas that I excel in, and what are some areas you find that are weaknesses for you, and how have you approached hiring to help you with those areas that are weaknesses for you?
So I'll answer that question. I do want to go back to, unfortunately, a roundabout answer. The sales, the revenue piece is so critical. And the point I was trying to make that was too long is that you got to hire salespeople and revenue generators, or people, you know, chief revenue officers, depending on what your business is. And because the business will only go so far if it's dependent on you. And we see that all the time. So and the point I was trying to connect was you got to hire revenue generators who are consistent with your value system. So point number one, okay? As it relates to my personal strengths, that's the question, my personal strengths and weaknesses?
Yeah, that's right.
You know, my personal strengths is that I do believe that we are a value-driven organization. We are committed to our clients. You know, when I'm solving problems, it's with an optimistic perspective. And I'm not afraid to solve any problems. You know, it's interesting, you know, been married 25 years and I used to be the problem solver for everything. And about 4 or 5 years ago, I started coming home saying, I always want to be a guest at my house tonight. I don't want to be the problem solver. I just want to be a guest. And it's taken a long time for the family to adjust to that. But I really, when I go home, I want to be a guest. You know, I think my biggest shortcoming, and I have plenty of shortcomings, but my biggest is the lack of awareness of communicating where you're going, what you're thinking. We do a great job communicating internally around day-to-day operations and serving our clients and developing clients. And we have a phenomenal team. I mean, I've never had a better team than I do today. I'm as blessed as a human being you can possibly imagine based on the quality of team. And I'm forever grateful for that. I it's a lot of work because for me, I automatically think, well, this all makes sense. You understand. But we do need to do a much better job internally and even to our clients sometimes giving context around, you know, because we are innovative. We're very innovative and we're very entrepreneurial. So we're moving the ball a lot, moving the needle quite a bit. We are actively trying to grow our business and we just haven't done the job. In hindsight, I wish we could have and certainly should have in communicating where we're moving. We're, you know, not just to our clients, you know, to our partners and our lawyers and accountants and insurance agents and our team. And that's one of my 2021 goals is to be a world-class communicator to all of our stakeholders.
Okay. So it's great that you recognized it or you have recognized it. Why do you think that has been an obstacle for you? Right. And what was the process of discovering it? Because we're talking about the hard things, right? So it's obvious. Like when you say it out loud, you should have a vision. You should have a why. Right. And you should be able to communicate it. That's what people talk about. Oh, these are all the attributes of great leaders. But again, what may be easy for someone else could be difficult for you. So what was it? What do you feel like was the barrier to really prioritizing that? And then how did you become aware of it? And what are you doing about it now?
Yeah, I mean, you know, my mom said forever, she may still say it today. I don't know. But, you know, I held people to unrealistic expectations. And certainly the first, you know, I've been in business 30 years, first 15, I did it. I didn't even know I was doing it. And the communication piece, why I was not good at it, because everything seemed so obvious. Like, well, why do I need to tell you this? This is what you need to do. I mean, this is obvious, right? And this is how you do it. This is obvious. And reality is, it's not. And for me, I was so rooted in the why we do things and how we do things. I assume people were equally as rooted, and they weren't. Not because they didn't want to be. They just needed context. And in my mind, I've always had context to why we're doing what we're doing. And you know, that's not fair to anybody, right? And so it's hard work for me specifically to do that. And I have to work at it no different than I have to work at working out and the diet and everything else that goes with it. But you know, I'm actively trying to be better. And you know, we're also at a point now from a scale perspective. We made some really critical transitions the last 2 years. We made really critical transitions, big moves for our business. And in my mind, I still feel this way, necessary moves. And I don't regret the order of those changes at all. Who knew COVID was coming, but we did what we did. And this is the year we have to be world-class communicators. We have to get really good at it. And I'm committed to it. No different than, you know, our transition of custodians, no different than moving spaces, no different than launching a new company 4 years ago. I mean, just, you know, I'm committed to that today.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the things I've watched and admired about you is your commitment to community and supporting community and building relationships. How important is building, nurturing relationships to being an entrepreneur?
For most entrepreneurs, I mean, there are examples of true blue technicians or scientists. But for the vast majority, I don't know how you can build a business without being relationship oriented. And I don't know how you can build a relationship without being authentic. And that's, you know, one of the things I love about our client base is they're authentic people, and they're relationship oriented. But I don't, I mean, there are exceptions, of course, but the vast majority, you have to learn to be really, really good at it, or it's got to be natural for you to build relationships. I don't see any other way, frankly.
All right, so let's get back. I mean, we kind of zoomed out, went to the overview. We talked about the why and the importance of it. I want to zoom in a little bit on the issue of relationships as it relates to sales, right? And as an entrepreneur, that is, it's going to be heavily relying on you, at least initially, sure, your ability to build relationships and sell. For someone who hasn't done sales, right, like a true technician, like you said, they now have to put on a sales hat and go out and talk about their business, build relationships. What advice do you have for folks when it comes to not always pitching, not always selling, but the art of doing both, yeah, right? Creating win-win situations, which is so essential in business.
Yeah. I mean, you have to invest in other people. You have to give them something before you take. And really, take's probably the wrong word in 2021. I don't know you can take anything anymore. And I learned a zillion years ago that I can sit down with any entrepreneur, I mean, literally anybody, and I can explain what we do. And in that conversation, they're going to be excited. They're going to agree we provide a valuable service, but 10% of those conversations immediately become clients. Now, over time, the vast majority do, but I learned the hard way that people, for this, what we sell, it's a very emotional engagement for folks. And so they have to be ready to do it. And I think that's one of the things how the world's changed in general, that, you know, there's an instant gratification component where people, you know, sometimes want gratification right now. And then the other piece of it is that people have access to so much information that they're going to research and they're going to make a decision when they're ready. And they've been taught that, hey, don't do something you're not comfortable doing. And so you have to be patient. And so when you're talking about relationship building, you have to give, educate, and then be patient. And because of that, one of the challenges we have is you have to do that much more relationship development. I mean, you can't pick three people and hope they all work. You have to pick 300. What I still marvel at today, even in our own business and our clients, I mean, our clients' businesses, it's unbelievable how much they've grown. It's remarkable. Business moves fast now. I mean, it moves really, really fast. And you have to be prepared for that as the entrepreneur and as the salesperson. Things can move quickly. And I do also feel, particularly living in Columbus, Ohio, and people like you and what you're doing, creating this entrepreneurial ecosystem, you can get big customers, big clients from anywhere in the world now. And you have to move fast and be prepared for that. I could spend 3 hours talking about how to manage that process, and because moving too quickly and could put you out of business. So you have to really figure out and understand, you have to be prepared to move fast and move fast, but not so fast that it wounds you or maims you in some way.
Okay. Awesome. Now, chat, go ahead and throw in the comments if you have a sales call coming up, because we're going to get into something very practical, right? Can we leave these folks, Randy, with something where they might be able to close some business this week? Again, talking about sales and generating revenue and that being so critical. One of the things we've been focused on at 614 Startups is really creating a value proposition, right? What are you going to be able to communicate, whether this person is an actual buyer today, like you said, that 10%, or will buy from you later, or has an aunt, uncle, dad, cousin somewhere who will buy from you? You need to leave them with that thing that you do, the value proposition, where they can make a decision about you and your business. So how do you approach value proposition creation? And then how do you communicate value to your customers when you are talking to them? Because that is very a critical part of the sales process.
Well, I mean, it's a complicated question. You have to have a really compelling value proposition first and foremost. I mean, you have to make a decision. What business are you in? If you're in the selling hamburger business, it's going to be really, really hard to create a unique value proposition. It will be entirely relationship based, where you're getting people to your business, your hamburger or business, because it reminds them of some nostalgic thing, probably, right? if you're talking about general, you know, technology sales or even selling a car or selling a house or selling a building, whatever, you know, what my experience for most people is ask the honest question, like, you know, does this make sense for you? Yes or no? Why does it make sense? And if you're getting authentic answers, it helps you ask better questions to get down to the root issue. I guess fundamentally, Elio, what people need to do is get to the root issue of why somebody is considering buying from you. So it's so, most people discuss symptoms, they discuss, you know, solutions, but not the root issue. And I just can't stress how important, if you can, you know, craft your questions in a way, and again, authentically, to get people to answer, to get to the root issue, you'll find out that either, you know, why they aren't buying or what it's going to take for them to buy from you. And sometimes they're just never going to do it. And that's okay. Just move on to the next person pretty quickly.
But, all right. Awesome. So, I mean, a lot of no's can be expected, but that value proposition, I've found that when we create a value proposition that's tight, it's to the point, people can tell us yes or no in the short term, but they can also identify other people that we need to be talking to. And that's one of the things that we found when we go out there and we present our message. You know, it's about creating that win-win. Here's our value proposition. If the answer is yes, yes, we will close on the dotted line. If it's not now, it's that whole follow-up process. And then if it's no, we usually get, but have you spoken to X, right? Because everybody knows someone else who could potentially be your customer.
And I also think, you know, it's a really great, great question, because one of the other issues is that 99 times out of 100, when you start your company or early stage, you will not have the right value proposition. You won't have that right. And getting feedback from prospective customers why they're not buying from you or what they want, you really need to be committed to working on getting the value proposition correct. And for early stage companies, it's so critical, because you have to understand you don't know what you don't know, and don't pretend you know. Again, truth telling. Don't pretend you know. And really work hard to listen to your prospective customers, make sure they're the right prospective customer, and get your value proposition right. I mean, it really took us a solid 15 years. And I knew in my heart of hearts, like year 10, what our value proposition, it just took me 5 more years to get the courage to make the transition. And I'm a slow start, I'll give it. And I, you know, I didn't have resources like this available to me at the time. And so hopefully people can accelerate that period, that whole journey of really understanding your value proposition to make legitimate progress and headway.
All right. So the chat, thank you guys for being so engaged. We have a lot of questions in the chat. I'm going to turn it over to your questions so you guys can get involved and pick Randy's brain. So I have some questions here. Continue to put your questions in the chat. We're going to take maybe the next 15 minutes or so and answer as many of them as possible. All right, so first question. I think this came from Sean Roberts. He says, do you believe you need a unique idea to be a successful entrepreneur? Or do you believe you can become successful improving someone else's idea?
Oh, I definitely believe you can become successful improving somebody else's idea. And, you know, we have a lot of those clients who, you know, somebody had an idea and they made it better. And so, I can spend a lot of time on this topic too. You might have the exact same idea as somebody else and you rip off exactly what they do, but you create a better culture and therefore you have a better team delivering that. So is that the unique idea? Maybe, I don't know. Is the identification of a better culture or unique culture the idea? It might be. And I'm okay with that. You know, so again, I don't think there's a silver bullet answer to that question.
Yeah. And if you guys are thinking about becoming a podcast host, don't do it. I have this whole game on lock. It's not going to work for you. Forget about it. Okay. This is total domination over here. All right. And then also, I mean, talk about in the news of somebody just simply improving or replicating on an idea. Disney Plus just hit 100 million subscribers in 16 months. This is streaming services. Netflix was the 800-pound gorilla, or is the 800-pound gorilla. Disney Plus, probably aided by the pandemic, has been able to add 100 million users, right? in 16 months. Talk about taking somebody else's business model and applying it to yourself and creating success. What is Disney without theme parks? What is Disney's or Disney without movie studios? All of that stuff was shut down. They pivoted to streaming and now they have 100 million users. So yes, of course you could take somebody else's business model. And if you have the content like Disney does, they could create a whole new business line that might even dominate some of the others in the years to come. So
I'm very curious, you know, Volkswagen announced recently that they're going to be 100% electric and autonomous vehicles in 10 years. And I really wonder what that does to Tesla and other cars. I mean, you know, will they create a better, you know, they have longer history, deeper pockets, arguably a more universal brand, maybe not cooler brand, but different. And I think you'll see somebody make a better product than Tesla at some point in time.
Yeah, and I think Volvo has made the same commitment. So a lot of people playing in the space, of course, everybody overlooks GM, but GM's doing what they do. Talk about deep pockets, talk about too big to fail. I don't think Tesla is at that level. So talk about entire economies betting on certain companies, right? So no matter what they do in terms of innovation, we know GM is too big to fail. So they definitely have support beyond what they can do as just a company, right? They are economy, they're important to the economy. Their success is not an option. Right. All right, so let's see. Oh, this is a sales question. All right, so, and I'm not sure who this is from. I can't, Kevin Hammond. I hope I said that right. It says, why are your services so expensive? So if you're talking to a client and the client hits you with that classic sales question, I could get it cheaper somewhere. Why is it so successful? Do you see that in your business as an objection that you need to overcome?
So, you know, our specific fees and services are, you know, it's a relative term, how expensive they are. You know, what we identify is we serve a very specific type client. And in order to serve that client the right way, we need to have a certain amount of revenue associated with that. So, you know, we're not trying to be everything to everybody. We're trying to be really, really valuable resource to a certain population. So, and, you know, one of the harsh realities is that, and I, you know, so I love what you're doing here, is that it's entrepreneurs will take a ton of time. They'll suck up, and they should, they have to. And so, you know, we remain a for-profit business. And so with that in mind, we want to stay in business. And so we have a certain fee structure that works. However, and without doubt, there's so many more resources out there for folks to use to grow their businesses from scratch or early stage. You know, a simple, very simple thing I'd say, read every one of Jim Collins' books. There's other great authors out there too, and I can go on and on about some of them. You know, Traction's another one with Gina Wickman. There's a lot of resources out there for growing businesses. And I think that's back to cash flow. Cash flow and food telling, you got to make sure that your what you're selling creates cash flow and it's meeting the needs of the right constituents. I mean, it's just a truth telling situation that you can't sell more and lose money every sale you make and stay in business. You can't.
Yeah. And you know, that is a tough question. There's no easy answer because the fact might be, yes, it is too expensive. They just can't afford it. And that's not your ideal customer. But sometimes that's, you know, that's not, they just don't understand the value proposition. It's not truly that it's too expensive. They really don't see the value proposition. So again, that's why the value proposition is so critical.
And I recognize that for what we do and our unique expertise, we had a product, we had one product for a certain size customer, and now we have a new product for businesses that are $300,000 of sales, $1 million of sales. We have on the chalkboard right now, or whatever, the whiteboard, you know, something that is for businesses that are earlier stage than that could be affordable. It's just we're going to do it in a fashion that we can stay in business and be profitable all along the way and understand our cash flow.
All right, and talk about market research. I see my guy, Alex Brown over there, and he's an attorney friend of mine. And we were having a conversation. He said, if you're building a business, do not sell to lawyers. They are the cheapest. Lawyers are the cheapest. So if you have an idea for selling to law firms, Alex Brown has already told you that's all the market research you need to do. No matter how much it costs, it is too expensive. All right. So take Alex's advice. If you have a company selling to lawyers, pivot now. All right.
Unless you're in the clothing business, if you sell suits and ties, it might be okay. We see that if you're in the clothing business, you might make it. Might be all right.
And if they wear a lot of suits and ties, maybe you need to be a dry cleaner for lawyers, right? You come to the law firm, pick up their clothes. Yeah, Alex, see, we're solving problems here, man. We could still sell to you. All right. So wealth management for entrepreneurs. This comes from Warner, I think. Wealth management for entrepreneurs, what does that entail? So what do you do for entrepreneurs when it comes to wealth management?
Yeah. So, you know, first generation entrepreneurs view their businesses as ATM machines. Like they, you know, there's the cash, whether they need it personally or business, they go get it. And they don't understand how to view the business's balance sheet separate and different than their personal balance sheet. And you know, the problem with entrepreneurs is that there's always competing interests with what you need personally and what the business needs. Do I buy that new car or do I buy that new piece of equipment? Do I, you know, get a bigger house because I have two more children, or do I hire this person who can really change the business? And it's a constant battle because let's not forget, entrepreneurs are human beings and they're people and they have emotions. And so, you know, they it's a struggle. And it's, you know, that's it really. You know, it's, they have to, so the wealth management piece, help them understand how the relationship between their personal needs and business needs compete with each other, and how you can structure your wealth. And in my opinion and experience, you really have to structure everything about your wealth and your liquidity and your banking around growing the business and growing the business at the right rate, which we help them define what that rate is. And so, because that's number one mistake, or not number one, but one of the earliest mistakes people make. They grow their business at the wrong rate, too fast, too slow, and growth sucks cash, growth sucks energy, growth could kill relationships. And so we really help understand, based on your life goals, you need to grow the business at this rate and then align all your resources around that. And, you know, and if you have a family, there's all the competition with education and insurance and vacations and all that kind of stuff. They go hand in hand. It's just that you have to understand. And you have to understand the mindset of the entrepreneur. They're very connected to each other.
Yeah, and I always think about it in three phases, right? Some people are great at making money, but they might not necessarily be great at keeping it or growing it. And, you know, the opposite could be true in any other combination of those three things, right? So it's about making it, it's about keeping it, it's about growing it, right? Sure. And like everything else is a skill. And so don't beat yourself up if you have had a couple of at-bats and maybe you did well in any of those areas. Like everything we've talked about today, it can be learned. All right. I think we maybe are going to take maybe one, maybe two more questions, and then we're going to sign off. We thank you guys for being so engaged. You still have an opportunity if you have a genius question to skip one of these two that are on my list. So if you have any questions in there, please still throw them in the chat. There's an opportunity that I might ask that question. All right. So I wanted to ask this because early on, I didn't even know there was a difference between a financial advisor with an ER and an advisor with an OR. This question, I think, is another question from Warner. It talks about, would the financial industry be better served if financial advisors with an OR were required to be fiduciaries? Do you have any opinions on that?
Yeah, I mean, the short answer is yes. I mean, it's...
But you, hold on, Randy. But you started off selling any and everything.
Yeah, I just happen to have a moral compass. I mean,
okay, all right. I mean you said it, so you know I have to challenge you on that when those advisors start, they're really out there pushing product in a lot of cases.
So Eli, let me tell you something. Here's how stupid I was. I thought I was a fiduciary, even though I wasn't. It took me 10 years to figure that out. And you know, I didn't really truly understand the legal definition and implications of it. But I mean, it's so frustrating that we're not. I don't understand how it's even possible that we're not all fiduciaries. It makes no sense to me.
Okay. And I know you probably can't give investment advice, right? on a show like this. But what do you think about what the market is doing right now? I know we are on a lot of seesaws. There's fear about inflation. What is worrying you about the market right now?
So I'm going to answer a different question. I am super excited about innovation in America. I don't think I've ever been more excited. And so with that, I think this market is really complicated. It's very tricky. But if you have the ability to believe in America's innovation and look at those sectors that, in my opinion, are really obvious, which I won't say what they are on this in this environment, I think it's a blind, and you make these investments, just move on, and you're gonna be very happy in 3 years. I think what's hard about this market environment is it's hard, you know, if you look at it in a purely historical fashion, it's very hard to make sense of the current market. I think it's a mistake to look at it in a purely historical fashion. I think you have to look at it on where is it going. And America is going some really phenomenal places. It's hard to feel that way because we've been under a year of negativity and a year of just really difficult situations for people in ways that I can't even begin to fathom and understand. So I can appreciate why people can't get the same optimism I have. But boy, oh boy, we're going some really great places. And you know, so this is, if you really truly can stick with a 3 to 5 year window, this is a super simple environment to make some money in. Maybe not tomorrow, maybe not in a month, maybe not 6 months, but 3 to 5 years, you're a happy camper.
Stay the course is what I'm hearing.
Make, you know, look at what's happening and stay the course.
All right, great. So I know we had some polls out there. Thank you guys so much for participating in those polls. We're going to review the polls and then we're going to close. And we got a lot more episodes like this coming. We got Ryan Frederick of AWH coming up on my next episode in April. So you guys stay tuned for that. All right, let's look at the poll. Poll number one, I would recommend this show to a peer or colleague. Strongly agree, 57%, agree, 29%. Okay, neutral. Who's the neutral contrarian? Brian, we will discuss who the neutral contrarian is later. All right. I found today's content to be relevant to the tech and startup community. We got 29% strongly agree, 43% agree. We got two neutral people. Oh my goodness. I'm not going to sleep tonight. All right. What was the successful about today's show? Quality of the content. All right. 7 out of 7. Okay. Oh, okay. This is not rank order. People like the content quality. They like the quality of the speakers and opportunity to engage and interact. Thank you guys so much for being interactive. And then how did you hear about this show? Social media. All right. We got some friends referrals and the newsletter. Oh, in fact, the newsletter sign up is right there. A lot of great content. So I get my news from Tech Life, right? They are great curators of what's happening in the startup ecosystem. If you're not signed up for that newsletter, and you want to stay on top of what's happening in the startup ecosystem, sign up for that newsletter. It's in the chat. Do you intend to connect with other attendees on LinkedIn? We got a couple of people who want to connect. We just talked about relationships. Why wouldn't you connect with everybody on here? All right. We only had three. We had more participation on everything else. And we talked about relationships and business. Listen, were they listening to us, Randy? Did they miss the point?
Yeah, exactly.
All right. So connect with everybody who was on here. Next show, I'll be mindful to ask everybody to introduce themselves in the chat, but we'll do that in April. Stay tuned for that. Thank you, everybody. Thank you to my super producer, Brian. Thank you so much to my guest, Randy. I'm recording live from the Urban Accelerator X right here in Columbus, Ohio. Check out 614startups.com for all the news and information on the startup ecosystem. Until next time.
Thank you, Elio.
Peace. Thank you, guys.